That I love all your new songs that I've heard so far.
Thank you.
They're all really good.
So, I think they are really good. I'm excited about them. I'm excited.
How did you get signed to your label?
Well, we were on different labels before in the past, and after a long time of contract negotiation and a little Ouija power, we got out of it, and then we did some demos for the new record. We made our new record ourselves before we had a label, and then everyone heard the record. It's like, wow, this made a really great record. So then everyone wanted to have us, and we just chose with the label we went with because they're cool people. They have the same kind of vision as us. So I think we made a wise decision. Only time will tell.
So, either of you have anything to add to that?
He is so pro, man. This is great. They're just here to look good, I think, most of them.
That we do.
I'm the muscle.
He's the muscle here, and Rob is the brains. Come on.
Well, no, Rob's the looks, so I'll be the brains today.
So. Oh, today.
What would you say Gabe is?
Well, he's not here, so I guess I can really say what Gabe is. I don't know what Gabe is. Gabe is the tall one. Gabe's the one who he can see very far away. He's very good at basketball. Actually, for a really tall guy, he's very uncoordinated in basketball. Rob, who's smaller than Gabe, considerably.
Muncie Bogues.
Yeah, he's like the Muncie Bogues to Gabe's Manute Bol. He's not good.
Yao Ming.
Yeah.
So it seems kind of like the Knitting Factory show was really a very kind of an important show in your career and a little bit. And am I right about that?
I agree with you 100%.
Totally.
I think that not only was it, because we had been out of the loop for a little while, making these new songs and making a new record, and to come back and to play a show to people at home. You know, that to show that you still have people that care about you, show and you know, for us to display our new music, then yeah, it was very important. Really, that was a nice little kick in the butt for us to say, wow, you really still have a great fan base, and you know, it was very important.
The coolest thing about that show is that like 5 or 6 days before, we put a new song up on a website, and it was the first time we ever played it that night, and everyone in the crowd knew, like, well, not everyone, maybe like few people did, but most of the people were singing along to it.
99%.
I'd say about 98.6% of the people there were singing along to it, and it felt really good. Right, Rob?
Feel good. Did you know the words to the new song?
Yeah.
Good. So definitely 99%. Uh-huh. You were that 0.4% we weren't unsure of before. Sounds good.
Who wrote the songs on the new CD, or was it more of a collaborative effort?
Well, I think for this record, a lot of the music we did differently, where we sat down together and all kind of just jammed on things, as opposed to, you know, doing things more beforehand, like on your own. A lot of times someone would come with a structure of something, and we'd just tear apart and do it really different. Like, there were songs that we had, like, Is It Me, Is It True, was, who's that? Hey, what's up, man? Sorry, but it's not like Is It Me, Is It True, when it first came, it was like a normal kind of rock song, and then I think I was just making like a reggae song, and then Heath was like, you know, and we tried like that, and then Heath was like, well, why don't we try it with like this little kind of riff thing, and then, so it all just kind of, everything was torn down, and eventually turned out to be that kind of thing with the riff, and it was really different. But as far as the lyrics, Gabriel wrote the lyrics to this one. I think he is he can reach a very troubled place within himself, which is a wonderful thing, because with real, true art, you know, if there's a difference between making music and making art, and music lasts for a little while. Art is something that's timeless, you know. And we'll always, you know, when you're 40, you know, and I'm 45, we can sit down together and we can listen to this record, and hopefully it'll still mean something to us then, you know. And that's what you're striving to do when you're in a band. You know, everyone can make music, but make true art. You need to reach some sort of place that's really pained and troubled, and you know, everyone can understand that. So I hope.
Best Revenge got a fair amount of airplay, and you were on Target's breakout artists, and my mom even heard like a movie in The Gap and stuff.
Really?
Yeah.
And got some free stuff.
Has this spurt of fame influenced your writing and view of the world?
I think that, I'm sorry, do you guys mind me? I think that a lot of the things that we experienced with the last record and the record before definitely influenced us in an opposite effect, because we were, it wasn't like we had a taste of what it was like to be famous and we're like, oh, we need to go after that. It was more of like we had a taste of whatever it was we had and we didn't like it at all, so we kind of went against that. You know, I mean, and I think that's what spurred on most of this whole new record, a whole new attitude with our band. I mean, you know, a lot of things that happened to us that we weren't very pleased with, you know, and we needed to change those things, and that last record really kind of shoved in our faces a lot, you know. So, you know, when you hear us playing it, not necessarily hear us playing at the Gap, but a lot of the things, you know, we learned the hard way of things that we don't like. So now, by knowing that, we know what we do like. So yes, it definitely, you know, spurred it on, and I think that it's very evident in the new music and what the new music deals with and the topics dealt in the songs. And just the whole overall attitude of our band. You know, like, we had a meeting one day, we're like, everyone grow long hair. Everyone start growing a beard. I'm on my way here. No, I'm just teasing. That's not true. I'm teasing. We just don't care. Like, it's a different thing, you know?
This is actually some hair. Not even laziness, lack of time. The past 3 weeks have been like hell for us.
Yeah.
Like, we haven't had one day where we've just been able to chill out and do nothing.
Yeah, it's been difficult, and shaving is a time-consuming thing. You know what I'm talking about. You know what it is. It takes forever. So, I mean, you know, it's a hard thing to do. You don't always have time to shave or get haircut.
To tell you the truth, I'm actually going to start shaving, too.
Wow.
Very good. I didn't actually have to start shaving until I was probably about, I think maybe like 16 or 17. And I remember first I grew only one sideburn. Only one of them grew in before the other one did. And I didn't care because it was so cool to have a sideburn that I just rocked one. I just had one sideburn. I didn't care. I was so proud of those hairs. I didn't want to. So I had some stubble going on here and nothing here. Fortunately, now it's starting to grow in, and it grows in blonde and red and all kinds of weird colors. So you might have a little rainbow beard going.
Just don't do that to yourself.
Yeah, you don't want to have the one sideburn. That was my point. Thank you, Keith, for bringing it back. Just because you can grow it doesn't mean you should have it, kind of thing. Because it was not cool.
Especially with, like, dying facial hair. That's...
Well, no. I don't even dye it. It just grows.
No. What else do?
Yeah. So facial hair is about to be dyed. I tried that once, too. And I went up with green on my face. It was dyed in my skin. My mom had to take me to some
place. What part of your face did you dye?
I think it was my sideburns. Was kind of
did you dye your hair as well and it got all over your face?
And I didn't even notice it the next day when I was at school. And then it was like in a different light, and then I realized I had like big green splotch on my face. Very embarrassing. Very traumatic. Never dyed my hair green again. She never should have dyed my hair green in the first place. I think. Not my color. It doesn't complement my skin tone. So.
This one's for Rob, and this might get you in a little bit.
Get me in.
I can read this one. Let's see. Rob, how come you're not taller?
Thank you, Mom and Dad. So I'm going to hear another one. Do a little.
No. Okay, for real. You go fire away here.
Has managing I Surrender and pretty much running it given you a new view on the way you look at other labels? And like labels that you're being signed to?
Labels we're being signed to? You know, honestly, it's on such a small scale compared to so many other labels. And I started it because I enjoy working with bands, and I enjoy, you know, just the, you know, physically going out, being able to help a band put out a record and, you know, try to get it in stores. You know, so, I mean, the thing that you don't realize is it's not just pressing a CD and then that's it. You know, there's just a lot that goes into it. But it's definitely rewarding in ways you wouldn't realize, you know? Like, you know, I guess it's like if you have a kid, you know, I think you have a kid, right? Not funny. Thanks a lot. No, but really, it's like, you know, just to be able to see the bands grow, it is really, you know, it's something that's pretty cool. Pretty special. Like, he's cool and pretty special.
So it just took Rob 15 minutes to say no. That was basically the answer to you. Sorry.
What was the question?
Because it changed your opinion on the views of all the labels that we signed to. I'm just teasing. I love Rob. Rob's a good.
They have like a million people working for them. Like, they have these.
But on the other, I have to admit though, just from seeing Rob working on the label, that he has been working very hard, and it's a lot more even for me because I'm not usually involved in any kind of business sense with anything, and for a good reason. But to hear all the stuff that goes into it, to anyone who's thinking about starting a label that, you know, it's a lot of work. And it's a big commitment, I think, that you've made.
Thank Alex for helping me out.
I'm proud of you.
I'm aware of Alex helps me do the label, so now I can lay back and do interviews.
That's right.
Do you have anything?
That's all I have.
Very much.
What are your hopes? What's your goal?